What's up, guys? Awesome Nerd Show here, and today I'm starting a new video. I don't know exactly what to call it yet, but I'm actually going to start getting into doing videos on wrestling, which is what we've been wanting to do since the start of the channel, but didn't know what to do because all the things I know what to do are stuff people have already done before, and I kind of wanted to find something new. But what I'm doing isn't anything brand new or anything. It's just something I've personally never seen before. So this will probably be rough for the first couple videos and stuff, but hopefully it'll get better over time and stuff, because this is what I'm planning is a long range, like a long running sort of thing. There'll be one video a week, and it'll probably either be Sunday or Monday. I can't decide which day I want. As of right now where I'm recording it, it's Sunday, so whether I can get it done and upload it today or whether it'll be for Monday, I'm not exactly sure. But I'm going to get into wrestling, and it's going to be reviewing the Monday Night Wars. So what I'm going to do is go with a correlating week to where we're currently at. So today it's January something. Let me see. The 8th. So January 8th when I'm recording this. And so I'm going to take a look at the very first Monday Night Raw and Nitro that correlates to this day or the week or whatever you want to call it. And so, but I'm going to start with 1997 because that's when I think the shows really start to pick up and everything. So with each show, I'll kind of go through and what the background like story type thing is. And then I'm going to go through each match or whatever kind of thing and just say what happens. Most of these will just be like, oh, this is the match, this is who wins and stuff, because there's not much that goes on. It's a lot of filler type stuff. But when actually we get into story type stuff, that's when we'll actually stop. So that's why I'm saying this first stuff may not be very good because there's not much going on. So we're starting off. I think I'll start. I don't know whether to start off with Raw or Nitro. For now, I'm going to start off with Raw. So that's WWF at the time, WWE now. And then go to WCW Nitro, which is Monday Nitro. And I have a whole list of papers, which I'm actually missing a sheet that I don't know what happens, so I'll have to grab that real quick here in a second. But I have a sheet, so I'll probably just be reading off this most of the time because I can't remember a whole lot of stuff. But we're gonna go ahead and start with Raw. Now the reason I'm starting with Raw, so this was Raw from January 6th 1997, so of course my Nitro will be the same date because they're the same nights and everything. So Raw took place at the Knickerbocker Arena in Albany, New York. So if you know where that is and stuff, but as you can see, it's a Knickerbocker Arena, which I believe is a smaller venue. It's not their giant places they currently do and stuff. Now at this time, Raw was 1 hour. Now, I believe here in less than a month or so, they switch over to two. I believe it's right after the Royal Rumble. And speaking of the Royal Rumble, that's what is leading this whole stuff on Raw. Like I said, I'd give you background story. So leading into Royal Rumble is what we're looking at. So it's leading, of course, to the 1997 Royal Rumble at the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas, which of course is the biggest Royal Rumble there's ever been, like size wise and stuff. And that's where they're going to this year, later this month, for the Royal Rumble. We're turning back there, and it's been 20 years now, here in 2017. And so this is kind of why I chose the date and stuff to start this early. And so we have that coming up. And so if you don't know this, the whole main event for the Royal Rumble is going to be Shawn Michaels with Jose Lothario, which is his trainer that he, you know, when he became a wrestler, that's who trained him, which is a Texas legend and wrestler and stuff like that. And so we have Jose Lothario on his side and against Sid or Psycho Sid, whatever you want to call him. Now I do listen to podcasts, so we can go back to Something to Wrestle with Bruce Pritchard, which is Brother Love, if you didn't know, if you're an old time wrestling fan. And so he told they did an episode not that long ago on the Royal Rumble, so if you want to hear more about that, you can go download his podcast, especially on iTunes stuff. It's just Something to Wrestle With. It's a really good show. But he talked about, or they talked about, the background to the Royal Rumble, how in the year before, so 96, I believe that, so let's go back to WrestleMania. So at WrestleMania we had, which was WrestleMania 12, we had the Bret Hart versus Shawn Michaels, Iron Man match, which of course ended with Shawn Michaels winning the title. And then at that point, Bret like left to go do movies and shows and stuff like that. Well, he Vince ended up getting him to come back later in 96. And so the whole lead up to what was going to be WrestleMania, the 97 WrestleMania, which is 13, was to be a rematch of Shawn and Bret. So everything was working towards that. But as you'll find out, and if you don't already know, it did not work out that way at all. So up until then, it was supposed to be, I think at the Survivor Series of 96, it was supposed to be Shawn and Vader for the title, was supposed to be the match. But prior to that, they had supposedly tested matches and stuff with Shawn and Vader to see how the crowd reacted and stuff. And it wasn't that great, so they ended up switching it to Sid. And at that Survivor Series, Shawn was supposed to lose the belt, so then he could win it here at the Royal Rumble in San Antonio, since it's his hometown and stuff. It'd be like a hometown boy winning the thing, you know, in front of all his family and friends and his hometown, as I said. So they wanted to do that. So technically, Vader was supposed to have the title, but because stuff didn't work out, they put it on Sid. So Sid is the champion at this point. And so as the show opens, we have Vader, it's just like a pre-tape thing of Vader back there challenging Bret Hart because they have a match later tonight. You know, of course, saying the same old stuff, if I'm going to beat you, Bret, and everything. And then soon after that, there's an ad. It says for what was the premiere of Shotgun Saturday Night. So if you didn't know, it was like, I think, a midnight show. It was on at midnight. So it was very, like, raunchy or, you know, adult-oriented type of wrestling show. And it would take place at, like, bars and stuff. And so the Saturday before this was the premiere of Shotgun Saturday Night. And so they just showed, like, stuff that happened stuff. So then we have our very first match that opened the show is Owen Hart versus Mankind. So with Owen Hart, you have Clarence Mason, which why I don't know exactly. I think they were with Jim Cornette at the time, him and Bulldog, which were the tag team champs. And of course, Owen was the tag team champ and his Slammy Award winner, which was his big thing he did. And so you had that with, and so he was with Clarence Mason for something. I forget why. I think they brought him in to like sue for some reason about a title shot or something. So that's why they brought him in. And then, of course, Mankind at this point had Paul Bearer because Paul Bearer had split up from Undertaker. And, of course, later this year, he turns on Mankind and then goes with Kane and stuff. And there's not much to the match. I know there's a couple things where Jerry Lawler, just, of course, him being silly and stuff, Mankind, like, gets thrown out by or out the ring in front of him. And he makes a comment of, like, what's that horrible smell? Is Mankind wearing the new Michael Jordan cologne or something like that? So it was just kind of funny. And then I think Vince McMahon's like, I think that's the smell of formaldehyde or something. I just thought it was a funny little comment and stuff. And then we have, or they talk about Owen and Bulldog having their issues, which would come up, I believe, right after the Royal Rumble, which starts the whole beginning of the Hart Foundation, the new one and stuff. And then throughout the match, Owen picks up the title. So they go outside and fight a little bit. And like Owen picks up his championship title and he's like swinging it around. And like when he swings it, it hits Mankind, I think in the gut or something, like it's supposed to hurt him and stuff. And then, Mankind ends up there at the announce table. Mankind picks up a tray that has a bunch of ice and drinks in it, dumps it on the ground, and then takes the tray and hits Owen with it. And then the crowd starts chanting ECW. So that's kind of where we're at this point. And then there's another Jerry Lawler type same thing. They're talking about Jose Lothario not being the best health because previously Sid had apparently got his hands on him and hurt him and stuff. So it's all about Shawn getting back at him for hurting Jose. But they talking about him going to the doctor and stuff. And they said that Lawler says that they examined Jose and they found out he had a jalapeno for a heart. So it's kind of funny because he's a Hispanic or Mexican, whatever you want to call it, and stuff like that. So it's kind of funny. There was a commercial during the match, which they had a commercial for Full Metal, the album, which if you don't remember, it was like Freddie, classy Freddie Blassie sitting in like a music studio type thing. And they start playing like entrances and you have little kids dressed up as the wrestlers. So it's kind of funny Because you see, like, a watch, I think it's funny. It's like a little kid dressed up as a gold dust. So he's doing the whole that, and he goes, hot, like that. And I just thought it was funny being with the character, kind of character gold dust was, and having a little kid interpret him or whatever. It was kind of funny. But then we had, and then went back to the match. And of course, there's a whole match going on, but it's, I'm not going to do play by play kind of thing. But it ends with Mankind doing a pile driver onto, Owen Hart after Owen had ran and like kind of speared himself into a ring post, and so he was weak from that. Mankind grabbed him and did a pile driver, which that is a thing at this point in time. You see a lot of pile drivers between this and WCW, so you'll hear that mentioned a lot. So that was our first match. They went to a backstage segment with Shawn Michaels and Jose Lothario and Jose's son. I think his name was like Robert maybe or something. Of course, just talking about Sid attacking Jose and stuff, and Sean getting all fired up about, him attacking his mentor and everything, and he's gonna get back at him. So then we go to a longer preview thing of Shotgun Saturday Night, where the advertise showed the match or some of the match of Ahmed versus Crush, which at this time he had gotten back from jail or whatever, and so he had the like tattoo on his head and everything. And at this point, Crush was with the Nation of Domination. So during the match, the Nation gets involved a lot into the match, and they fight outside. And I think D'Lo Brown, which is just a no-name member of the Nation at this point, when they're outside, gets pile driven or something onto the top of a car and everything. So there was that advertisement. Then there was a Godwins versus the Flying Nuns, which they just look like nuns with the giant wings, like the Flying Nun. But they had a match. I think they ended up winning by cheating or something, because a Brother Love had came out. So Bruce Pritchard, as we mentioned, I mentioned earlier, and then he claimed them that they're going to be called the Sisters of Love. But even though they're two guys, I didn't understand that at all. So that was that advertisement. And then we go back to match number two, which is Diesel, which is Kane, if you didn't know, Glenn Jacobs, and then the Fake Razor. So Fake Razor and Fake Diesel tagging together against Phil for Furnace and Lafon, I forgot what their name was, which are two like Canadian wrestlers or something that were like big in new like Japan wrestling and stuff like that. So this is pretty, boring match with all these people, but you have Honky Tonk Man out on commentary saying that he's looking for his new protege, which I believe ends up becoming Billy Gunn, the Rockabilly or whatever that he becomes. But anyway, so it's a two segment match, so it kind of lasts a while. So you have a commercial in between with Furnace and LaFon going over, winning, I think, through some like cheap roll up type thing or something. And that gets them makes them undefeated. I think Vince said or something, continues their undefeated streak. And then so we have a recap of last week's show. So the Monday before, after this match, and it shows, a match between Gold Dust and I can't remember who it was, but Triple H came out and he kidnapped Marlena, so he just put her on her shoulder and kind of took off, which Marlena was Gold Dust valet, which or his wife at the time and stuff. Some other stuff happened, but that's all I really remember from it. Then we have Brett backstage complain about how Sean's whining about Sid and everything, but yet Sean likes to interfere in people's matches and all that stuff. And then talks about his match with Vader, saying that way he doesn't always have to worry about that stupid guy or something, so he calls Vader stupid, which is weird and stuff. And so then we go back to the ring where Sid is out there. Of course, he's the heavyweight champion at the time and stuff, and so he has an interview in the ring with good old JR. And so he's, of course, if you know anything about Sid, he's rambling on at some promo, kind of like I do. But he's rambling, and he says something about he was born to be the man, and he's gonna walk out the Royal Rumble as the man and stuff like that. So kind of pretty basic, boring stuff. And then, of course, as he ends almost everything, he says, "I'm the master and the ruler of the world." He's kind of common saying. And then Jose and Sean come out because Sean's getting ready to do commentary for the Bret and Vader match. And so Sean comes out, and the crowd's of course cheering loudly and stuff, and Sid starts laughing and everything into the mic that JR's holding and stuff, and saying like, "Yeah, this is what I wanted to see," and all this stuff, whatever, and that how he's gonna beat him and everything. But anyways, he leaves the rings, and then it starts to go to commercial. Before it does, Sean's, of course, standing up on the announce table this whole time as Sid's talking to him. And at this point, Sean has taken his shirt off. And then as it starts to come up, cut to commercial, he's starting to, what looks like, take his pants off. So that's Shawn Michaels at this point in his life. If you know about his drug problems and everything, that kind of explains that. And then we come to our main event. So this is only a three-match show, which, of course, it's only an hour. So that's why it's so short and everything. But we have Bret Hart versus Vader, of course, with Shawn Michaels on commentary. So throughout the match, Vader gets thrown into the steel steps. He tries to do a Vader bomb off the top rope, but the ref comes over and is like waving at him stuff like not to do and everything. So he gets down. And I think he gets back down to the second rope and does the Vader bomb, but Bret moves and stuff. So that kind of switches over. And then Stone Cold, or it shows Stone Cold watching from the back, just sitting in front of a monitor watching them fight. Sid comes out, grabs the cameraman that's standing like in front of the ring, and he's like going, come on and stuff, and he puts his hand on his neck and they go to the back. And while that's going on, the whole that thing, Stone Cold then comes running out while people are distracted and stuff, and attacks Bret Hart from behind. So that allows Vader to come out, grab him, throw him into the ring, do a Vader bomb on him, and win the match. So Vader wins the match against Bret. And then it goes back to the locker room where Sid was, and this is how the show ends. And it shows Sid grabbing Jose's son, like, again, I said, I think it was Robert or Rob or something like that, and grabs him and power bombs him into a table, and that's how Raw ends. So that's how Monday Night Raw ends, of course, for this episode. So not much of anything going on. Like I said, it's building up to the Royal Rumble, and I think for the biggest Royal Rumble that they've had so far, as in size, so having to sell tickets and stuff, it wasn't that amazing. But the show itself was interesting, so I may, do a recap of that when it comes the time, because I just love the 97 Royal Rumble a lot and stuff, so I may do a recap of that. But now we'll move to Nitro. But before, I gotta go grab the pink, so I'll be back. Okay, so now we're back and ready for Nitro, which of course was the same day of January 6, 1997. And this one took place in the Monroe Civic Center in Monroe, Louisiana. So we're down south this time. And so the start show we have on commentary. So if you didn't know, with Nitro, this is a two-hour show. And so it took place... So the first 2 hours would have a set of commentary team, and then at the second hour, it would switch, and they would do the new commentary team and stuff. So to start, we have Tony Schiavone and Larry Zbyszko, which I always hate the first hour because I hate their commentary and everything. Like, I find Zbyszko annoying, and Schiavone is just a play-by-play guy, so he's, doesn't really add anything. But anyway, to start off, we have our first match of Glacier, which, of course, is the Sub-Zero wannabe knockoff that never turned out. But he comes out wearing a samurai helmet. I never remember him wearing that from the stuff I remember. I always know he had his, like, face mask thing. But he had that and a samurai helmet on, which is kind of weird. But he faced beautiful Bobby Eaton, which Bobby Eaton was part of the Midnight Express and stuff, so a famous tag team and stuff. So he's here now on Nitro, which Nitro and WCW is full of old-time wrestlers that were kind of like on their last whim of relevance and stuff like that. At least that's my opinion of it and everything. But so for this match, we just had Glacier, who did a lot of kicks and like karate type moves and stuff, because that's his stuff. And he wins with a pin on Bobby. Like I said, I don't even know what his finisher was. I tried looking it up, couldn't really find anything. That's how a lot goes. It just seems like matches in, like, I don't know what their finishers are or anything like that to know how they win. So that went by. Then we came up with match two, which was a Mexican strap match, which I remember from WWE, the like Puerto Rican strap match or whatever they did, I think earlier that year, or in 96 or something like that. But it was Big Bubba, which is Ray Traylor, or Big Boss Man, as some may know, and he's a part of the NWO at this time, against Conan, with Jimmy Hart, and they're part of the Dungeon of Doom, I believe, at this point. And so, of course, this is a strap match, so it's a giant like leather strap attached to each guy's wrist, and they have to go around and touch each corner without being interfered. And by this, I think they gave the guys like a few like 30 seconds or so of interference before it like was wiped away by knowing WWE. As soon as like the guy was hit or stopped, they had to restart. So they were doing that. So since they have a strap, there's a lot of choking and slapping each other. So like balling it up and like, or like grabbing it with a like big part of it and then like slapping, and of course choking. And then like I know a couple of them wrapped it around their hand a bunch of times to use it as like a heavier punch. And then Conan ends up winning, as he had touched all corners, then like Bubba grabbed it to stop him, and as he was trying to reach, like he stopped him, he pulled him in close, and then Bubba like had it wrapped up and punched him, and Conan fell back, and when he did, he hit the turnbuckle ended up getting the win. And so that's it for the second match. Okay guys, sorry, I had to get a piece of gum, my throat so dry. So after that second match, we then went to an interview with Mean Gene, with Kevin Sullivan in the back. And of course, Kevin Sullivan at the time is called the Taskmaster, so he's known as Kevin Sullivan, the Devil, and the Taskmaster. Of course, he's the leader of the Dungeon of Doom and everything. But speaking about having problems with Chris Benoit and woman, which is Nancy Sullivan, his ex-wife, because they got a divorce or whatever, and she ended up with Benoit and stuff, so they took that whole real life aspect and brought it to the TV and everything. So they just did that leading up to a match with Kevin Sullivan later on. And then after that, we had Mean Gene standing out front at the entrance of of course Nitro and everything, like they do, which I thought that was kind of cool about WCW doing. They would do interviews at the entrance ramp and stuff. But Mean Gene's out there, and he brings out the Four Horsemen, which at this point consists of Ric Flair, Arn Anderson, and Steve Mongo McMichaels with Deborah, and I believe Benoit's also part of it. Him and Woman and stuff, but they gave Benoit and Woman the night off because dealing with the whole Kevin Sullivan type stuff, and so they're not there. And they're talking about Jeff Jarrett, whether he's a part of the Four Horsemen or not, and Arn Anderson keeps saying that he's not a part of the Four Horsemen. And then Jeff Jarrett ended up coming out, trying to make his claim that he's a part of the Four Horsemen and everything, and it insults Arn, and so Arn attacks him, and they fight to the ring and stuff, and then a match starts and everything. And then so it's just a little quick like back and forth with mostly Arn, but Jeff Jarrett gets the upper hand and then goes for a pin, and he puts his feet up on the rope to get the leverage and stuff, and ends up getting the win. And then all the other horsemen come in to kind of like break up or stop what's going on. And Deborah's like getting in front of them all, trying to protect Jeff Jarrett. So I don't understand what the whole thing with that is, because I know she's Steve Mongo McMichaels, I think it's his real wife, Deborah is, which Deborah was in later on in WWF with Jeff Jarrett. Then she was with Stone Cold during his heel run, where he was played the guitar and all that sort of stuff in the early 2000s. So I don't know exactly what her thing is, but yeah, it's like she likes Jeff Jarrett, but because of her husband and stuff, they're trying to, I don't know, it's really so weird. I'll have to look into it. So there's that. Then we get into an NWO commercial, which is their famous black and white commercials and stuff. And they are selling a poster, which is signed by the group. It's got a picture of, I don't think it's all of them, I think it's just the outside, Hall and Nash and Hulk Hogan and maybe X-Pac and stuff. I don't know exactly. But it's them, and it's a signed poster and everything. So then we come to match three, which is Lord Steven Regal, or William Regal, as you may know him, of NXT management. And he's the current TV champ against Hacksaw Jim Duggan. It was supposed to be, forget who it was that he was supposed to face, because they played his music, but he never came out. And so it ended up being Hacksaw instead. Which I have to say, their music, like, I forget what William Regal's is, but it's some Mozart type thing or something, Beethoven sort of stuff. And then Hacksaw has just like some like classic American music or whatever, like a 4th of July type music type thing. So their music, I think, is horrible. Besides, like, the NWO, maybe the Four Horsemen, Harlem Heat, and stuff like that, like, everybody else's music is just random and generic and has no, like, you could hear it 500 times probably and still be like, who's this person? That's my opinion. I mean, obviously, if you heard a lot, you'd get to know them, but. So during this match, you have Eric Bischoff, Kevin Nash, and Six, or X-Pac as you know him, come out to do commentary. And they, of course, just talk crap the whole time and stuff and don't add any sort of commentary. Of course, there's a lot of USA chants since William Regal's from England. And then you have Hacksaw doing his USA, USA sort of chants and stuff like that. And then we Bischoff makes a comment about WCW guys needing to sign new NWO contracts, or if not, they're gonna like be terminated or something like that. So I think that was just some stupid thing trying to start in an NWO brand type thing. And then the match just ends because there's a time limit reached, so it ends up in a draw, so no one wins. And so that's the end of that match. Then we go to match number four, which is Humorous Hugh Morris, or I think it's Bill DeMott, or that was. He was the NXT trainer, which got fired, against Jim Powers, which I don't know. The name's really familiar, but I don't know if he did anything else. But he's with Teddy Long, so the Holla Holla guy from SmackDown management and stuff. He's the manager at this time, and I know he was a ring or a ref. Then he became a manager, and at this point he's real like chubby, like he's got a real fat face and a big like thick body, so he must have lost a lot of weight and stuff by the SmackDown days and stuff. But just a basic match, you know, nothing special. But Hugh Morris wins with a moonsault off the top rope, and it was a very nice moonsault for him being such a big guy and everything. So that was pretty decent. So then we move on to hour two. So at the beginning of every hour, there would be explosions and stuff like fireworks and pyro and everything going off on the entrance ramp. And then you bring out the new announcers of course, Tony Schiavone stays, and you got Mike Tenay, which is from TNA fame and stuff. Of course, he's with WCW first. And then the great Bobby Heenan, which of course is just like Jerry Lawler. They both say some of the most ridiculous and funny things. I don't think I have as much for him because it's hard to catch him somehow. And I did realize during one point, like I think it was him and Tenay started to talk, but Bobby Heenan started to talk, so they stopped. And then Bobby Heenan was like, "Go ahead, Mike," and like said a couple times. Well, then Mike started talking at the same point. Bobby started talking again, so they both just stopped. And then Sean was like, "Go ahead, Mike. Go ahead, Mike." And he had to say it like three times before Mike Tenay actually said anything. So that was kind of funny. Showing you the chaos that goes on at WCW and stuff. But the first match of the second hour is Cruiserweight match of Psychosis versus Rey Mysterio Jr. It's pretty your basic Cruiserweight match for this time in the 90s. There was a botch of Psychosis where he went to do, like, say this is the rope. He, like, stood up and, like, went the, like, where you sit down on the rope and then, like, flip backwards out onto that. But when he like did that, he didn't like bounce back. He just kind of hit and then like fell backwards onto the apron part, the right out part, right outside the ring and stuff. So it was really weird. That, and then he went to do a jump from the ring out to Ray on the outside, and he climbed up on the rope. And as he's gonna jump, he like fell backwards instead. Like he didn't just completely fall back, but he like lost his footing and fell back into the ring onto his feet, and then climbed up again and then jumped. And Ray ends up winning with a springboard into a pin. So, like, he got up, jumped, and then got on the guy and, like, rolled him up into a pin and stuff. So, Ray Mysterio wins that match. Then we have a match number six, which was Kevin Sullivan with Jimmy Hart again, because they're part of the Dungeon of Doom, versus Chavo Guerrero, or yeah, Chavo Guerrero Jr. And Sullivan pretty much just dominates the match. So they're destroying everything. And then he wins with the Tree of Woe, which is where he just hangs the guy upside down in the corner and runs across from across the ring and knees him in the stomach. But I like that name, the Tree of Woe and stuff. So then we have a recap of last week's Nitro, where it had the NWO destroying Roddy Piper, because he had just returned at the end of last year for I forget what the Starrcade, I think, was their giant pay-per-view. And at that pay-per-view, it had Roddy Piper versus Hulk Hogan, the rematch of WrestleMania 1, like trying to bring back that. And Piper ended up winning, but because he won and Eric Bischoff's in charge and the head of NWO and stuff like that, he confiscated all the videos and claimed that Hogan actually won and stuff. So Piper was out there, you know, celebrating, and NWO comes out and just completely destroys him. But before I mentioned, though, Piper was out there, you know, celebrating, saying how he won and stuff, but is also saying that was going to be his very last wrestling match, so kind of make it all special and stuff. Then NWO comes out and destroys him. He ends up getting taken out by a stretcher and then off in an ambulance and stuff. and I guess during that thing, there was also a thing with the Giant, because, which is Big Show, if you didn't know, because he was in the ring, I know, but then they talked about how he had turned or did something wrong. Well, ended up Hulk Hogan apparently beating him up and stuff, leading to the events later on tonight. Because the Giant was in the NWO, and then there was some problems, so they ended up like kicking him out and everything. So that'll be coming up in a little bit. But then we had match number 7 of Alex Wright versus Eddie Guerrero, which was probably, in my opinion, the best match they had of the show. And Eddie Guerrero's the U.S. champ, but he doesn't have the title because at the pay-per-view, which he beat or won the title at or whatever, Six, or again, Xbox, came out, beat him up, and then took the title, and so now he's in possession of it. And but Eddie's the real U.S. champ. So of course this is a very, it's like a fast-paced match, but yet they do, or but they do a lot of chain wrestling and a bunch of holds, but the holds don't last very long, like they're things, but then they quickly transition them or switch to another one and stuff. So it's pretty decent for a cruiserweight match and stuff, like compared to nowadays. And then you have Six come out and set up a ladder in the entranceway because they're going to have a match at the next pay-per-view, which was the NWO sold out. And they're having, as I said, a ladder match. So he sets a ladder up in the entrance, climbs up to Thomas, is sitting there like saying, "Come on, Eddie, come get me," and everything. And of course that distracts Eddie to give Alex Wright the upper hand in the match and stuff. But then Eddie comes back and wins with a superplex from the top rope. And then he frog splashes and gets the win. And then it goes to, let's see, what do we got next? Oh yeah, then we got a little like, I want to say commercial, but it's not. But it had Lee Marshall. I don't know who he is exactly, but I know I remember in the Nitros I've watched up until this point. He's just some guy that calls on the phone. Like, they show a picture of him and then, like, where he's at in the United States. And he just calls, like, from the next town they're going to be in the next week. And so he's calling from New Orleans, because that's where he's going to be the next Monday. And he pretty much gives, like, a culture type thing, like he's saying, you know, "Oh, I'm here eating gumbo," and stuff like, just stuff like that. And pretty much all he does, so it's, I don't know what Lee Marshall was or what he did or anything besides that, but he just kind of would give them, like, what's going on in the next town they're going to be in. And then we go to match number 8 for the night, which is the Amazing French Canadians, but they are, I believe, the Mounties or the Quebecers in WWE, and then they come back, and I think they're the Quebecers again. I know in 98 for a little bit, but they're with Colonel Rob Parker, which was just some weird guy. He was always Colonel, but he dressed up like Colonel Sanders, or at least that's what he looked like to me when I first saw him and stuff. But this time he's in like what I assume would be like a Canadian military outfit type thing. And they face Harlem Heat. So Stevie Ray and Booker T win there with Sister Sherry. And of course, Harlem Heat wins with, I think it's called the Heat Bomb, which was like a double team move type thing. So nothing special there. It's just Harlem Heat and stuff, which was a pretty good team and everything. And then we get a promotion for NWO Sold Out, which is their very own branded pay-per-view type thing. Again, going with the separate brand. And then we have the last actual match for the night, which is Ming, or Haku, as you may know him, versus Lex Luger. The match was a decent, tough match. Like, you know, just two big, strong guys just in there fighting each other, beating each other up, punches and kicks and stuff like that. Luger puts Ming up into the rack attack, you know, trying to finish. But while he's doing that, doing the rack attack on him and, like, moving around, they end up hitting the ref. So the ref gets knocked out. And during that, Barbarian comes running out and attacks Luger. So he loses Haku, and he ends up doing some fighting back and getting Barbarian up into the rack attack. And then the ref comes back and sees, you know, Barbarian giving up. And he calls the match and gives Luger the win. And, you know, doesn't realize there's a difference between Barbarian and Ming and stuff. So he just sees him and calls for the win. And then that leads to the very last segment of the night, which is NWO, which I'll just get to that at the end. So you have NWO coming out, and you have, like, all the members, which this is the beginning of 97, and they started the NWO in July, something like that, of 96 at Bash at the Beach. I don't know, maybe August or something. And they already have what seems like 20 plus members in the group, even though I know it's not that many. But they're like all the, like, lower end members are standing along the sides of the entrance, along the W. They have the giant, like, steel plated or diamond plated WCW signs. They're standing all over that. And then out comes Kevin Nash, then Eric Bischoff with, I believe it's Miss Elizabeth, because they, like, took her from Randy. And of course, they were, Randy and Miss Elizabeth were, like, divorced or broken up at this time. And then at last, Hulk Hogan comes out with, of course, the spray-painted championship. And they get to the ring, and Hogan talks about how he beat Piper and everything again, because they took the tape, so no one knows. Or they have no proof that Piper beat him and stuff. And then how he beat up the Giant the week before all by himself. He himself took on the big Giant, was able to do it single-handedly with a couple punches and everything. And then the Giant comes out and gets into the ring. Starts clearing out people from the ring, I think. And it gets down to Eric Bischoff and Hogan. And Hogan ends up taking the chair, because I think he's, like, goes to attack Hogan, but Eric Bischoff interferes. And while Giant's focused on Bischoff, Hogan gets a chair and comes and hits the Giant, knocking him down. And then the rest of the NWO comes back in and starts attacking him. And then, so they do all their beat up and everything. And of course, trash is filling the ring at this point because the crowd's so mad and everything. So they get done. They start walking towards the entrance ramp, but they turn and go over to the commentating table, and all the people leave. And it's funny because Bobby Heenan ends up getting up on the, like, climbing up and over the table, even though everyone else just goes, you know, from the sides of the table towards the, facing the camera sort of thing. But Bobby goes up and over the table. So it's kind of funny. But they're there, and they start singing We Are the Champions and stuff like that. Then while they're doing that, Sting comes down the ramp and goes to the ring and grabs the Giant and starts, like, whispering something, talking to him or whatever. And then he ends up leaving his bat in the ring after pointing to the NWO and stuff. He puts it down in the ring and leaves. And then they send Vincent or Virgil, Million Dollars Man's, like, sidekick type guy, sends him to the ring to get the bat so they could have, you know, the NWO wants the bat and everything. And so he's in there getting the bat with the sleeping Giant, as they say. And so he's in there, he's, like, kicking the Giant, you know, to make sure he's out and stuff. And he picks up the bat and then start poses in front of the Giant. Like, yeah, he beat him up. Well, then the Giant comes awake and choke slams him. And then the NWO starts running back to the ring, and Giant's up there just taking the bat and like trying to swing at the guys as they get in. And that's how the show ends. So that's it for Nitro. Okay, so that's our recap of Raw and Nitro for January 6, 1997. So as you can see, there's Nitro is longer, but it's got an hour longer, but it doesn't have a lot of like when I say good stuff or storyline stuff going on. Pretty much all Nitro was NWO. So without at this point, without NWO, there's nothing, you know, to draw you in. And so that's why I think they had the success they did, because people are like, we don't know when NWO is going to come out. Even though they're usually out during a part in the first hour for some small thing, and then they have their giant stuff at the end of segment two. So I think, you know, people would just be able to see that and like be able to know when to watch it. But I don't know if with the 2 hours people were more drawn to it because they get more wrestling and stuff. But that's my opinion, is that if it wasn't for the NWO, WCW, I don't know how they made it, because they just had a bunch of old wrestlers and boring, bland wrestlers. Where I think WWE had the people with more personality, but yet their matches weren't good or entertaining. Like, I wanted to fall asleep during them and stuff. But to get to, like, the origins of all this, me and my brother, which bro may join us in a couple episodes in the future and stuff, or may, once he starts, he may do all of them and stuff going forward. But we were wrestling fans at this point, which of course is considered the golden era heyday of wrestling and everything. And I was a WWF person. He was a WCW, well, more WCW, just because he thought the like camera, the lighting. He said with WWF, you always got that smoky feel from like the pyro and stuff, which I do see that. I don't know how WCW did it, because they always would do the pyro stuff and fireworks at every segment, but they could of course had some sort of air filter type thing. But he said that's why he liked it, where I liked WWF at the time because I liked the wrestlers more and stuff and what was going on. So I remember when we were kids, we used to share a room, and I'd always like, he always had control of the TV because he was older. And so he'd always be watching WCW, and I'd be like, go back to Raw and stuff. And I'd always just beg him. Dude, of course, Raw ended up winning, or WWF ended up winning the war in the end, if you didn't know, spoiler alert. But I just remember doing this. So I'll probably be more biased to be on the side of Raw, which I think especially here in a couple weeks to months going into 97, Raw definitely does get a lot better. But I think WCW kind of picks up more too going on as well. So I'll just have to see. But I would like to be like pick a winner, like which show was better, but I can't really, because to me both shows were pretty boring at this point. Like I said, with Raw, the only thing real good thing was the build up or building towards the Royal Rumble, and Nitro, you had the in or the coming off the Roddy Piper thing with Hogan, and then going into Sold Out, so featuring, you know, being a main feature of NWO and all that sort of stuff. Like I said, I can't really have like a winner type stuff, because I don't know how to judge or anything. I'd like to, but if you guys have any ideas, please let me know in comments down below. Let me know what show you thought was better out of the two. Like I said, I can't decide. Let me know if you like this segment. It was, by the look of the timing, it was a little long. I know I got to cut some breaks out and stuff. So that'll make it a little shorter, but it's kind of longer than one. But I want to go through more in-depth stuff. And so I had 3 pages of notes here of the shows. And so, of course, I'm watching these on the network. So if you want to watch these, you can either go on the network, or I'm sure you can probably find them on YouTube or something. But you can get them on the WWE Network for, of course, the $9.99 price for now. And you can watch all these, because I decided to do this because I've been watching pretty much since the network came out, like after it went through a couple bugginess for the first week or two. And then after that, I started watching Nitro or Raw from the very first episode. And so I've made it all the way up to like January, February in 98 so far. Of course, I've not been watching it every day. I just watch it whenever I have some free time. So I thought, I was like, hey, since I like watching this, I might actually do a video because I've been watching some Nitros too. Like, I watched the 96 Nitros from the start of the NWO. So I finished that month or the 96. So now I was ready for 97. So I was like, I can just go back, do them all together, present them here at the time for the Royal Rumble of 97, which we're coming up on the anniversary. So that's why I want to do a recap episode of that, just to kind of have it fresh of what it was like before and everything going into this month's show. So it's just additional video that I wanted to, again, getting more into wrestling, going into a long term format, because I want to go all the way up to the end of Nitro. So that would be, if I do 1 week, that's going to be, 3, 4, 5 years from now. So as long as I keep doing it for that time, we'll be doing these episodes and stuff. Of course, if I may feel I want to do more, I may start doing multiple a week or something like that. not exactly sure, but please let me leave any comments. Let me know what you love. Again, I know I'm not the most exciting or energetic person. Like right now, my throat hurts a lot because I don't talk very often, and so this has been a long format for talking. So my throat's killing me right now. So that's part of it too. So leave any comments, like critique and feedback you think on this, what I can do better, what I can add to it, that sort of thing. If you enjoyed, please leave a like so I'll know if it's, if you don't, it wouldn't really matter. I'm still going to do it. But you can either leave comments or liking to let me know if you thought it was good or anything. And then, of course, subscribe to see more because we'll be doing one every single week. Like I said, I want to do it on Sunday to not distract from Monday Night Raw and everything else going on Monday. But it may be Monday because I usually don't have time to record until Sunday. So try and get it done and edited. And that same day could be tough and stuff with a long format, but we'll just see. So again, please like and leave any comments helping me out. Subscribe, and we will see you next time.